Thank you, Judge Horowitz. Good morning, and may it please the court. This court should reverse because the district court's determination that the Bad Spaniel's parody dog toy was not an expressive work protected by the First Amendment was wrong. Once that fundamental mistake is corrected, all of Jack Daniel's claims fail. Whether or not the Bad Spaniel's parody dog toy is an expressive work is reviewed de novo by this court. Regarding the trademark infringement...
But let me ask you a question on that before you go farther. Assume that we agree that the district court erred in not finding it an expressive work. We still have to apply the two-part Rogers test, don't we?
No, Your Honor. That argument was waived by Jack Daniels.
Well, put that aside for a second. Put your waiver argument aside. Let's assume we have to apply the Rogers test. Wouldn't we remand to the district court to apply that in the first instance?
No, Your Honor. For the first reason...
You can tell me why it's waived now.
Yeah. For the first reason, it was waived below. It was not raised in response to our motion for summary judgment under Rogers.
Does it matter?
It does matter.
Argued below that the judge... The Rogers test, of course, is not applicable in a case in which there is not expression. And the judge found there was no expression. So I'm not sure how you waive, then, the test that ought to be applied if it is expressive. That's a step a little bit too far for me, so explain that.
I would say, Your Honor, unlike the mark holder in the recent Gordon versus Drake case, in this case, Jack Daniels put all of its eggs in one basket and said, Rogers is not applicable. This is not expressive speech.
It said Rogers is not applicable because this dog toy is not expressive, they said.
Sure.
And the judge held in their favor. The judge said, you're right, it's not expressive. I don't have to apply Rogers. Now what if we find that it is expressive?
Is that the basis of your waiver argument?
Pardon me?
Is that the basis of your waiver argument, what Judge Horowitz just summarized happened?
Yeah, the basis of the waiver argument is neither on appeal nor below at any time that...
They argue strenuously on appeal that the Rogers test should have been applied.
They argue that it should not have been applied. And the Rogers test is...
Don't they argue that even if it's expressive, you still got to go through two other steps?
The two other steps, in answer to your question, if Your Honor were to find the Bad Spaniel's parody dog toy was expressive, no, this case should not be remanded for a new trial by the district court. There's a two-step, it's a burden shifting.
You think we should do it?
I think you should do it.
Everybody always thinks we should do it.
The end result that VIP proposes is that the court reverse and remand with instructions for the district court to enter judgment in favor of VIP products.
So let's get to the merits of the issue for a moment, because we all agree that the first question is whether or not this toy is expressive.
Sure.
Why is something that dogs chew on expressive?
Sure. It's expressive. Well, I'll start with the basic principle, which is McCarthy summarizes cases and says that parody is a form of artistic expression under the First Amendment. Parodies convey a message, one that businesses shouldn't take themselves so seriously. In terms of the dog toy, the medium of the expression is not dispositive. The Tenth Circuit stated, we see no principal distinction between speech and merchandise which informs our First Amendment analysis. In the Walking Mountain case, these were postcards. If, for instance, VIP were to simply take the Bad Spaniel's dog toy and make postcards out of it, or a book, would that be protected under the First Amendment, but the toy not? And then the other thing, part of the speech that's being conveyed is that brands should not take, we're free to laugh at brands and they shouldn't take themselves so seriously. Part of the speech being conveyed can only be conveyed through a toy, which is the squeak.
Now, I understand your argument that the district court erred in saying it can't be expressive because it's being sold commercially. But even if some commercial things are not expressive, do you agree?
Yes, some commercial things are not expressive. And pure commercial speech would be an advertisement or an infomercial or that sort of thing.
So let me ask the question I just asked you a little bit differently. What does this express?
Sure. And if I can take a little help from the 10th Circuit, where they were dealing with a case dealing with trading cards that were parodies of baseball players, and they were sued by the company was formed to do this, and it was sued by the Major League Baseball Players Association. And what they said there is, because celebrities are an important part of our public vocabulary, a parody of a celebrity does not merely lampoon the celebrity, but exposes the weakness of the idea or value that the celebrity symbolizes in society. In this case, you can take that exact same concept and switch the word celebrity to famous brands. Because famous brands are an important part of our public vocabulary, a parody of a famous brand does not merely lampoon a famous brand like Jack Daniels, but exposes the weakness.
What if your dog toy?
We just had a Super Bowl.
Yeah, I remember it. but that wasn't my question. What if your dog toy were an exact replica of the Jack Daniels bottle?
Which is to say
it had all the wording and everything else on it, would it then be expressive?
If it were an exact replica, it would no longer be a parody. And
why not? Wouldn't it tell us, well, it's a bottle made up as a dog toy. It would tell us not to take brands seriously. And so what makes this one expressive as opposed, if you say that one with the exact same design would not be expressive,
well, I guess
would be expressive?
I guess I would like a little bit of clarification when you say the exact same design.
Let's just say you take a picture of the Jack Daniels bottle, and you design a dog toy that looks exactly like it, except it squeaks.
Would that be
a violation of their copyright?
It's a low threat. First of all, there's no copyright issue in this case.
Oh, trademark, I'm sorry.
In terms of trademark.
You intellectual property guys get us confused.
In terms of trademark, it's a very low threshold to meet the Rogers standard for an expressive work. So I would argue that it is expressive, but it could still violate Jack Daniels' trademark.
Because of the second part of the Rogers test.
Because of the Rogers test. Is it artistically relevant? Well, I don't know if you're doing an exact copy. It's no longer a parody. I'm not sure it's artistically relevant.
But you think it is expressive, even though you've exactly copied somebody else's trademarked design?
Well, number one, I would say that's not our case here.
Of course
two,
it's not our case.
I would say...
We all know that's not our case. You don't have to tell me that.
Sure.
To answer the question.
I would agree that it's expressive under the Rogers test.
You think it's expressive even then?
But I believe it would also be expressly misleading under the Rogers test.
Right.
And therefore would be found to be infringing of the Jack Daniels trademark and trade dress. But again, that's not our case here. We took old number 7, converted it to old number 2 instead of Tennessee whiskey. It's Tennessee carpet. There's a multitude of differences where we were trying to do what a parodist does is the enhanced. Bring to mind an element of the Jack Daniels marks and then twist it to make humor and to make fun. So I think it is an expressive work, both under this court's...
And you agree that if it is an expressive work, absent your waiver argument, we still must then apply the two-part Rogers test?
I would say based on the facts before your honors, there is no way that Jack Daniels met or could have met the Rogers test. This product is marketed, and this is in our reply brief, there was a color picture, with a host of other Silly Squeakers products. They're sold under the general name Silly Squeakers. The company is VIP Products. There's a disclaimer on the back of the product that says it's not affiliated with Jack Daniels. And I know this isn't in the record, but it's somewhat amusing. The new version of these toys has a survey on the back, which tells people how to answer a survey.
Let me ask you an unrelated question. Because there were claims and counterclaims in this case, one of the things you argued was that the Jack Daniels trademark was not valid because it was merely functional. Are you still arguing that on appeal?
Focus of our appeal, and I don't want to throw the kitchen sink in. We'll
rely on. I don't want to know what your focus is. I want to know whether you're still urging that on appeal. The district court granted summary judgment in favor of Jack Daniels on the functionality issue. Are you still arguing on appeal that the trademark is not enforceable because it's merely functional?
I think below we did not argue that the trademark itself or the trademark
dress.
Issue.
The trade dress.
The trade dress is specifically the bottle shapeless function.
Is that an argument you're still making, or are you abandoning it? Well, we need to know, because we need to rule on it if you're still making it.
I'm still making the argument, but the focus again is this is an expressive work under Rogers.
If we were to conclude that Jack Daniels didn't waive Rogers, what should we do? I guess we should send it back. District Court never really considered Rogers, did it?
Well,
it never got to that step. So should we just decide that ourselves or send it back to the District Court? If we conclude that, you know, Rogers applies in this circumstance.
VIP's position is that this court should decide that question. We're appealing two things. One, the findings of fact, conclusions of order, and order after the bench trial. We're also appealing the denial of the motion for summary judgment, that we were entitled to summary judgment under the Rogers test. In those pleadings, in terms of the summary judgment.
You can't appeal the denial of the motion for summary judgment. That's not an appealable order. You can appeal the final judgment, but the case law is quite clear that denial of motions for summary judgment are not appealable.
Well, then I would say that it's rolled up in terms of the findings of fact, conclusions, and law and order.
At no point below did
Jack Daniels ever argue that it could satisfy the Rogers test. And then it's
a burden-shifting test. My problem with your waiver argument is what you're saying was they should have said was, gee, we think it's not expressive. But if it is expressive, then you should have applied a two-part test. And the problem with that argument is they never had occasion to make the second part because the judge found that it was not expressive. And so I'm not sure why they were then required to say, by the way, Judge, if you'd ruled the other way, we'd have another defense.
In any event, I think based on the facts before Your Honor, no reasonable fact finder could conclude, based on the record at trial or on the summary judgment papers, that Jack Daniels could satisfy both prongs of the Rogers test.
Let me ask you one quick question on something we haven't touched on, which is the nominative fair use defense. As I read our case law, it's that defense is not available unless the items are identical. A lot of your case is based on the notion that the items are not identical. So did the judge get that right?
I will stand on our briefing on that point. That's not, again, the focus of our appeal is that this is an expressive work under Rogers, and it's fully protected by the First Amendment, and they can't satisfy the Rogers test. And so in terms of the nominative fair use, I know that was an issue that we raised with the appeal. And honestly, as I stand here today, I don't know the answer to your question in terms of the scope of the case law regarding nominative fair use. I apologize.
You wanted to save some time for rebuttal?
I do. I will just conclude. Yes, I will save time for rebuttal. Thank you.
Mr. Harvey.
Thank you, Your Honors. And may it please the court. I'm Peter Harvey on behalf of Jack Daniels. My co-counsel, Isaac Crum, is here as well. Your Honors, Jack Daniels prevailed after the trial of this action, after it proved that 29% of consumers, more than double the standard to show infringement, were confused into thinking that this dog toy was made, put out, sponsored by Jack Daniels. And also that the product was tarnished because it associated Jack Daniels, unsurprisingly tarnished, by associating Jack Daniels, a 150-year-old brand of Tennessee whiskey, with dog excrement. Now, VIP claims that this tramples on its First Amendment rights.
Well, the Fourth Circuit, in a virtually identical case, found that a dog toy was a parody and therefore did not infringe a trademark.
It did, Your Honor, and there are two important reasons why. The Chewy Vuitton case, the Haute Diggity Dog case, was distinguishable. from our case and why the judge went the other way. First, there was no evidence of any confusion whatsoever.
Well, but don't we, before we get to confusion, which is an element of trademark infringement,
yes,
don't we have to first address whether or not there's expression?
Yes.
And if there is expression, you agree we have to apply the two-part Rogers test?
If it's an expressive work.
Right, it's expressive work,
which
I'm
is
sorry.
A very important point right. to make. I mean, they've segued in their briefing from being an expressive work to being an artistic use to an expressive
use. I understand.
Use
so, but if it is
work.
An expressive work.
Correct.
The second part of the Rogers test really picks up this notion of consumer confusion, does it not?
It picks up the explicitly misleading question
right.
as to which there would be evidence.
So that you could have a survey that
yes.
showed that 100% of the public thought this was sponsored by your client, but if it were truly an expressive work, that survey would not be determinative, would it?
That's true, although it might inform the question of explicitly misleading. But let me get back, if I can, to the Fourth Circuit case and the other difference there. The court found it was an obvious parody. And that's an important finding that's very different here, because our judge below found that it was not a parody. Why? Because Acuff Rose sets the standard for that and says it must make a comment about the original. And in our briefs, we make it clear that Mr. Sacra, the president of VIP, multiple times in his deposition, repeatedly said this dog toy, this product, makes absolutely no comment about Jack Daniels. He said it several times, absolutely not.
Does the comment have to be about Jack Daniels, or can it be about?
The definition.
I have no idea what I have no idea what anything is about here. So, but it's not my job to come up with an expression. So, but it doesn't have to be about your product, does it?
It does. It does, with respect,
Why?
Your Honor. Because
to be a parody, it does.
Correct.
But to be an expressive work, it doesn't.
No,
does it?
It does not. And those are the two prongs, the exceptions to the application of trademark law, this balancing act between the First Amendment and trademark law. The courts have enunciated two different bases to say trademark law should not apply. One is it parody, which it's not, and two is it an expressive work? And if we look at the body of work, that body of case law that follows Rogers in the Ninth Circuit, of which there are six cases, look at what they do. They define what an expressive work is. It's media. It's media uses. It's a TV show. It's the use in a movie title. It's a use in a song, Barbie Girl. It's a use in several video games. It even goes as far as the Gordon case, Your Honor, where it reaches what Gordon itself says is the outer limits of what an expressive work is, namely the use of a trademark in a greeting card. This case is way beyond the outer limits.
Address the greeting card case, and I understand it's at the edge. Why isn't that one?
It's very helpful.
Instructive here.
Because the court found that it was an expressive use, because the mark was being used to communicate an idea, to tell a story that was readily recognizable by the hearer, by the viewer of the card. Oh, I get this. I know what this friend of mine is trying to tell me about my birthday. And so that's the issue. It needs to be understood. It echoes some of the speech, conduct as speech cases, Your Honor, where there are issues regarding whether the intent was to communicate a specific, a particularized message, and whether it was one that,
well,
under the circumstances, would be understood.
The message in the greeting cards case was, honey badger, don't give a...
Right.
It wasn't, excrement.
It wasn't a hoot either.
Yeah, it wasn't a hoot. Is that expressive?
Well, certainly that's what the Ninth Circuit found. The use of an expressive trademark in the context of a greeting card, yes, it was.
Yeah, the Ninth Circuit found that, and that's why I'm asking, why isn't the stupid things that are on this this dog squeak toy also expressive?
Well, we have Mr. Sacra's testimony that it said nothing about Jack Daniels. Then at trial, Mr. Sacra backed up and said, oh, what I really meant to say was big brands shouldn't take themselves too seriously. Well, the problem with that very generalized, non-particularized message is it's not particularized, and it's not readily something that people would understand.
What's the strongest case on your side?
Sorry,
strongest case? What's the strongest case on your side?
Dr. Seuss, Your Honor, which is good law, although they claim it's not, in which the Cat Not in the Hat book that Penguin put out somehow infringed the trademarks of Dr. Seuss. Why? Because it didn't say anything about Dr. Seuss. It talked about the O.J. Simpson trial.
Did it make a difference in that case that the product that they put out was the exact product that Dr. Seuss put out? In other words, he put out books. They put out a book. The book was designed the same. Here, the product is different. It's true.
The product is very different, although looking at it, certainly quite a number of people thought it came from us. The fact that it's a different product, it goes into the analysis, but it's not determinative.
But that is a distinction in Dr. Seuss. It's much easier to say, all you've done is change the characters.
And the message and everything in it. If it don't fit, you must acquit. And all that stuff in the rhyming slang of Dr. Seuss is a quite obvious effort.
But let me ask then, is Dr. Seuss still good law?
Yes.
Why?
I say that, they make the point that it's been somehow sub silentio overruled. It has not been. And in fact, in MCA, which is the adoption of the Rogers standard in the Ninth Circuit, as the court knows, the Barbie girl case, they contrast and distinguish what happened in Dr. Seuss from what was going on with Barbie, where it was clearly a parody of Barbie, and say, that's still good law. I don't expressly say that, but they're quoting it and citing it and talking about when someone uses another's marks to simply get attention and avoid the drudgery of coming up with something fresh, which is language from the Acuff Rose case, which obviously is a Supreme Court case and still very good law. That's a different story, and that's why the trademark infringement laws should apply to that. So just moving on through, I mean, I've said essentially everything I feel that I need to say. I mean, I think it's important, stepping back into the big picture, to recognize that the First Amendment is framed in absolute terms. And, there it is. Congress shall make no law made applicable to the states by the 14th Amendment. Except in practice, in reality, there are many exceptions to the First Amendment being absolute. Think about it. Now we've got laws, libel laws, slander, shouting fire in a crowded theater, laws against securities fraud.
And you want us to add one more, making squeaky dog toys?
Sorry?
You want us to add squeaky dog toys to that illustrious list?
I want you to add trademark infringement and tarnishment, yes, Your Honor, under the trademark laws. And so does trademark law. It operates to carve out, under very careful balancing tests that the courts have developed, the parity distinction and the expressive work Rogers distinction, as to when the law should be applied to that. And here the answer is they don't meet those tests for the reasons we've briefed. I think that's really all I feel I need to say, unless the court has further questions.
I don't, Judge Tashima. Judge Miller?
No, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Your Honors.
Briefly, Your Honor, with regard to the survey, what the Brown case said in the Ninth Circuit is adding survey evidence changes nothing. And in the original Rogers case, there was a survey and there were instances of actual confusion. They still found it a protected work, an expressive work, and non-infringing. There was also a survey in Brown. The Dr. Seuss case predates the MCA case by 5 years. And in that case, the
assume Dr. Seuss is still good law for a moment, since it's never been expressly overruled. And we're rather reluctant to find overruling by implication. Why isn't it controlling?
Why is it not controlling? Because in Dr. Seuss, there was no transformative use. What the court found is you just took the style of Dr. Seuss and created the work related to O.J. Simpson. And what the court in Barbie Girl said, or in Mattel MCA Records, is that a broad reading of Dr. Seuss would eviscerate the use of brand names as metaphors for the values they came to symbolize. And that's what we're doing with the Silly Squeaker line, including Jack Daniels, is we're eviscerating kind of the idea of this as a commercial consumeristic society and that brand names are gods. So there is a transformative use in our case. And in two of the cases following, two of the Ninth Circuit cases dealing with expressive works under Rogers were parody cases. One was The Walking Mountain, which was photographs of cut-up Barbies with kitchen appliances, and the other was the Barbie Girl song. So, in conclusion, Jack Daniels may have
It's time to conclude, so I'll give you another. I'll let you finish.
Okay. Jack Daniels may have been triggered by VIP's message conveyed by his bad product, but it's not entitled to the safe space it's asking for under this court's precedent. The court should apply its speech protective precedent and reverse and remand with instructions to the trial court.
Thank you, counsel.
Thank you.
This case will be submitted. We thank both sides for their briefs and arguments.